computer architecture. Let's take a look at another example of a classic famous architecture. In this case, the MOS 6500 family. And that starts with the 6502, as I will show you in a moment. I will I put here a couple of images, which I will all treat here on the left. I will all talk about this. But let's first talk a little bit about some text. So this is, we're talking about, let's say, 1975. And they started with the 6502. And the idea was to lower the cost, lower the cost, lower the cost. To give an example, the Motorola, which actually the MOS was a spin-off from this Motorola, they had a computer or a chip, a single chip, the CPU, in 1975 that cost $700. It's a 6800 chip of Motorola. And they wanted to make one, and they managed at the end to make one for $20. So you can imagine 35 times cheaper, that this can make some impact on the market. So some famous computers, which I will show you here, the maybe the most famous is the Apple II, and yours truly was starting the programming on the machine exactly like this. So it was running Apple Basic, and you had a monochrome screen, and this was, of course, was amazing, for, at least for me, that you could actually program some things. And this was in school. This was not really for the home market because it was too expensive, but then came out this computer, which yours truly had himself, that is the Commodore 64. That was in the range that everybody could have one at home, so it would, in today's terms, maybe cost a couple of hundred of dollars. And if you opened it, if you started it, this would be your startup screen, and then you could start running actually in BASIC. To give you another example, where do I have them here? So other famous things, here we have the Apple II. Here we have the Commodore, Commodore 64, Commodore 64, sorry, this was VIC-20. We have the BBC Micro, which is famous. Then we have, of course, the Atari game machine, which maybe you know. The other Ataris, Commodore PET, and a lot of other equipment, even modern equipment, it is running now with this processor. The chip itself. So let's take a look at what the technical specifications is. So it had 3510 transistors on 5 by 5 square millimeters. Okay, that's more or less the same as this Intel had, but of course much cheaper, the Intel 4004 that we designed in last lecture. So the chip itself, it's much bigger than the Intel, which had only 16 pins, as you remember. This one had 40 pins dual inline package. So this is what you see, dual line package is what we call DIL. The frequency was 4 megahertz, and it had a few registers, namely the program counter, of course, an accumulator. It had XY registers, so not a complete set of registers, but basically just X and Y to play with. It did have an instruction register, but not really, as we will see. It didn't have a classic instruction register. It had a status register, 8-bit, with negative, overflow, break, decimal, interrupt request, disable, 0, and carry, and if you count, this is 7, so 1 bit was always 1, as you can see here. And it had a stack pointer. So it did have a stack, and a normal stack pointer, not like in the Intel, that it had only 3 places for the stack pointer. No, it had a normal stack pointer that pointed to normal memory, so a classic, what we now call classic stack pointer. 16 address bus, so 2 to the power 16 times 8, the distance between memory elements was 8-bit. Between addresses was 8-bit, so you had in total 64 kilobyte address space, and that explains the name of this Commodore 64, because it has 64 kilobytes. 8-bit data bus and registers, von Neumann architecture, I think now all are von Neumann. And it had this, the registers, they were also, everything was 8-bit, the address bus of course 16-bit. Something funny, it didn't have a tri-state bus, but it has the bus with demodulators and things like this. Sorry, decoders. And it had a very funny rudimentary pipelining, meaning that, imagine, I think it was 4 clock cycles to execute an instruction. And in the last clock cycle, it would already start fetching the new instruction, because anyway, the data bus was not occupied and the address bus was not occupied, so why not already start fetching a new instruction? The funny thing is that it didn't have many registers. You just have your X and Y, but what it did have was something new, that is zero page addressing. And if you have zero page addressing, then what you do is, if you have an operation and it uses zero page addressing, then it fetches the next byte from memory, and this byte now represents 8 bits. This now represents an address in zero page. So you would have 16 bits address, but it would be only 8 bits of it would be used, and the other would be filled with zero. So you would get hexadecimal. You would get 8-bit 0 and then the 8-bit 0-page addressing. So the only thing it could do in this way, it would address the first page, the first 260 bytes of memory you could use. And they then, effectively, they were, for a programmer's point of view, they were like 256 registers. Of course, it's a little bit slower, but because you have to fetch this address. But not so much slower, because the memory itself all were done with the same clock. So there was not a bus clock and a CPU clock as we have nowadays. So it was quite an advantage that you had effectively 256 register at your disposition. So this is one of the address modes, and this 65 family had actually 16 different address modes. And the one you have here, zero page, the operand is at the address given by the next byte of code. Okay, let me put this here. Where do we have this on the left? Addressing modes. So we have here all the addressing modes. We have here the zero page, meaning that you have the opcode, which is 8-bit opcodes, and then it will fetch another 8-bit from memory. And this operand here, then, plus the zero from the zero page, then that is an address, and your operand is contained in that zero page address. So this brackets say, mean like the contents of, and then you have here a zero page address in between. So other addressing modes, which we already know from, for instance, from MIPS, is immediate, meaning that the operand itself is just the byte, the next byte in memory. So it is sort of like part of now, which is a 2-byte instruction, and the second byte is the operand. So this is like immediate. Notice also you have, for instance, you have implied. For instance, just increment the X register with one. This is just a 1-byte instruction. This is a 2-byte instruction, and you also have 3-byte instructions. For instance, when you do addressing modes, absolute. Absolute means you have your opcode, maybe you want to add, and then you have here 2 bytes in memory from the instruction segment, from the code segment, and these A and B then are the next bytes in memory, and these then represent an address, reverse order, so A least significant bits, high and most significant bits, the address, and the operand is contained in that address. So the address, the contents of address BA, and BA is given by the 2 bytes after the operation code. So you can see this, the kind of instructions, quite complicated. You have addressing that the operation is in the accumulator, that the operand is in the accumulator. You have implied, you have programming counter relative, so relative to the program counter. You have you can use the stack as your addressing. You can use zero page, absolute indexed, and absolute indexed indirect, absolute indirect indexed. Well, I will let you find out to if you want to try to imagine what it all means. It says here anyway, it says here at the end, you can read this and imagine what it all means. So I will stop here and then make a second lecture of about 10 minutes about this. What I've been saying here is I'll talk about what kind of programs we have here, what kind of addressing modes we have here and how basically how the computer works. And I want to point out here one funny thing, and that is that this image comes from the movie The Terminator, which you all know, with Arnold Schwarzenegger. And you, as you can see that in his head-up display, he sees this image, and in the left you can see how actually this assembly from the 65 family is being run at this moment, which is quite funny, but maybe a little bit nerdy.